And now for the balance challenge.
Challenge, challenge!
Which won't just actually be a balance challenge. It's just going to be getting the hips open and then trying some stuff out. But we're going to, of course, make it competitive because we're American and we're men.
Yeah! I'm going to win! I'm going to win! You're going down, Chip Conrad! You're going down!
We're going to start with something that I know he loves, which is the compass.
Oh, man. Mm.
Which is simply taking one leg up. And you can do it as high as you can, but the goal is to keep both legs straight. So if I'm up like this, and this back knee's bending to accommodate, then I'm up too high, so I bring it down. But I'm trying to get both legs as straight as I can, and then I'm gonna take this leg all the way, the same height, around, until I go into a bowling stance. And then I can bend this knee. And then I straighten this knee out and bring the leg back. And coming back is the tricky part, right through here. I'll turn and face the camera. This back quadrant here is usually where everybody drops the leg. And then once they get past that point, they rush through here and just put the leg down. So when the leg's coming back, it's coming back slow and controlled the entire time, all the way to here. Then we add a bonus where we put it on the other leg and do, I don't know, what's this called? A half tree pose, full tree pose? I don't know, my
sit squat.
Asana term, sit squat, there we go. So, that's what we're gonna do. Try that, open up the hips, and then we're gonna go from there.
Who's excited?
I'm excited!
He's not excited, here we go. We'll do both legs. So again, I'm trying to keep it the same height all the way around. Hopefully I don't kick Dave, I have no idea where he is at the moment. And I reach as far as I can.
Okay,
and then I straighten this leg back out. And I keep it the same height, nice and slow and controlled. You're not rushing this. Cross. I'm not rushing this. I'll do both sides a couple times. I have no idea what he's doing back there.
I'm trying not to fall, damn it.
That's a good goal. I mean, I don't want to tell you how to live your life, but. And again, do this to the height you feel comfortable with. I'll do both sides twice. The whole hip complex moves on this. At both hips. Even though one leg's up, both hips are doing a lot of work to keep you in place, to keep the other leg up. I'm compassed out. Now this is where we get to distract them. I won't look.
They're looking. See, all this is to show, it doesn't have to be perfect. Practice.
By the way, the compass is one of my daily practices. I do this just about every day, as long as I have some room. You need enough room to not kick something while you're doing it. That's probably obvious.
Oh, really? Nah, that level of challenge.
Take this balance idea and incorporate it into two movements. If you're into your categories, it's sort of like combining some yoga with some strength moves. But to us, it's all just movement and strength. The two for me are synonymous.
And stroga.
Yank. That
and
sounds stroga. Like something we compare. I have more yank.
I'm sure you do.
So this starts with a yoga asana called Warrior Three Pose, or at least my variation of the Warrior Three Pose, also known as the Birabhadrasana Tres. I don't know if that's accurate. So I'm gonna take my knee and raise it, my hands to heart, and as my leg goes back this way, my hands will go out this way, I'll eventually end up sort of Supermaning it here. And I'm trying to get as parallel to the ground as I can while keeping this leg as straight as I can. And it won't be too straight today. I'm trying to keep my hips squared so they don't turn too much. A lot of things going on here. I'm trying to hold that and then come back up. Now there's a part two to this. When I come back up, then I step out. I'm gonna come more center camera here. Then I step out with that leg into a Cossack, which I do on both sides. Then I bring this leg up, boop, and I do the whole thing on the other leg. It's self-reversing that way. And then back up, then it goes out, into a Cossack, both legs. We're just gonna try this and see where we land, so to speak.
You're going down, Chip Conrad.
This part right here is usually the trickiest for a lot of people.
Shut up.
Getting that. Can't talk and do this. Remember the breathing. Sink. Sink. Now I'm gonna bring this leg up. Wasn't beautiful, but I'll do it better next time. Wait, didn't I just do this leg?
Yeah!
I didn't do that right. Shit. Let's try this.
Your exercise too.
Let's try this again. Damn it!
I get a penalty point.
You get a participation trophy. Now I drive off this leg. Choo! I'm not even sure if I'm still on camera.
I am. It's the Dave Show now.
Better do well.
Uh-oh. Keep it.
Whoa! 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 I'm gonna try three per side, see how this goes.
Oh, shit.
I said me, you don't have to.
Oh, no. Sasquatch competition strong.
Oh, yeah. Hashtag Alabama Sasquatch.
What?
You're gonna IG the Dave there. Wow. Suddenly on this side, I'm drunk. Whoa. I feel your gravitational pull.
They're strong.
I'm gonna say it's these boots.
Nah.
That's two per side for me. Whoa.
Sufficiently challenged.
Unlike at the river, now we can definitely see. Oh, I should have given you only one brick to sit on, tower over you. That was one of the old industrial psychology tricks, is you always try to be higher than your opponents.
Boss would elevate his chair.
Elevate? That's an Alabama term, apparently.
Yeah, elevate his chair. Mm. So he was actually looking down on the peon that he was interviewing.
That's my goal in life, is to look down on the peons.
No, it's not. We're building people up.
Evaluating the people. Maybe we should delve into how everybody's different and we should approach training that way, because in our culture now, it's really easy to cookie cutter programs for people or worship somebody else who we're nothing like. And, you know, we're trying to emulate rather than empower.
Well, so that's interesting, because that gets into the deeper idea of goals and goal setting. Mm-hmm. More often than not, I find that my clients come to me with a very cookie-cutter set of expectations of what they're going to get.
What Dan John calls it, the A, not A.
Yeah.
They come
to
us telling us what they think we want them to be aiming for.
Our culture is so, it's so youth-driven, it's so image-driven that, you know, we're bombarded with these images of what is beautiful and what beautiful people are, and they come into the gym with the expectation that if I come here and I do this stuff, then I will become that thing. And so unpacking that becomes this huge job.
Well, one of the things I mention a lot in my workshops and my book is how one of our goals is to actually teach them how to have goals, how to create goals. Because when they come to us, we can only build goals on our experience. And oftentimes people come to us without having any experience in movement or strength beyond what they see in the media. And the media talks about movement and strength is based on the scale in the mirror. The scale tells you what the mirror tells you. And if that's their only experience, then they can only set their goals from that place. And so a big job as a trainer, as a coach, is to actually teach people how to create goals. Hey, this is a great big world of movement and strength. Look at all these things that are possible. Maybe we should explore that. And the scale and the mirror are going to change regardless for the better if you explore that.
And what you're describing is the fundamental process of how you work with general population clients.
Yeah.
Right? And there are a lot of people in our industry who take, honestly, an easier route and say, I am just a strength coach. All I do is I make people strong. Right.
And then they go even more so in this specific way.
And so they niche themselves very specifically down so that they essentially relieve themselves of the burden of having to go, okay, what is it that you really want? Right. And okay, all right, I hear that. Now let's talk about that and find out if that's really, really what you want. And
it's the question of why. You got to ask them why. And then you got to ask them why again.
Yes, and you got to work down to, you know, fifth, sixth, seventh level why.
So many layers.
Yeah, to unpack what's really going on.
Because ultimately everybody has the same goal, and that's let's make a better version of myself. Unfortunately, how that's packaged and marketed to us is a superficial, non-authentic way. So our goal is to help them find what it means to be a better version of themselves. And it rarely has much to do with six-pack abs.
No, no. Fundamentally, what I think it generally has to do with is make me lovable.
Yeah, yeah. But I want to be accepted and attractive to other people.
And
on that deep, deep level.
Yeah.
We want to be part of something bigger.
And there is a path there through this work, but it's not the way that you think.
Right.
I think there is a fundamental mistake that the fitness industry has made as a whole. I think that the industry aimed for low-hanging fruit. It aimed for...
Well, it is an industry.
Right, but it aimed for insecurity. It aimed for people who are unhappy, and it said, hey, if you do this thing in 6 to 8 weeks, I can get you where you want to be.
Mm-hmm.
That's not sustainable. Real people come to work with you. Real people come with, you know, with lives, with families, with problems. And if their goal is just a six-pack ab, so that six-pack abs, that's a very superficial goal. And as soon as life problems pop up, the gym is the first thing they drop because that's a superficial thing.
So that's interesting. When you have a superficial goal, the practice becomes superficial. Wipe it aside.
Whereas if your goal is to improve yourself so that you can be the best version of yourself for your family, your children, your parents, your coworkers, everybody in your communities, then that's no longer a superficial goal.
Right.
And that's something that becomes a priority.
When you're a participating tribal member, suddenly this movement and strength practice stuff is simply giving you the foundation to be able to do that.
Yeah.
One of the things I say a lot is the fitness industrial complex doesn't have a very good welcoming committee. It sort of throws people into the fire with all the glitz and glamour or empty promises or whatever. And it doesn't seem to actually be able to say, let's start a journey that we're gonna do for a long time, but from this very beautiful, simple place. Let's be a child's mind.
Let's consider this to be a path to mastery.
Right.
Right. And if it's a path to mastery, that means that it has to start where you don't know anything.
It's so hard to sell that.
And it's a long journey. Well, that's just it. All the other elements of our culture and our lives are geared towards our comfort, towards making things easier.
Mm-hmm.
Right. And so the physicality of our lives is actually something to be avoided on so many different levels. And then here we are selling this thing that is basically non-productive physical labor, sweat, effort, discomfort, all of these things, and saying, this will make your life better. And they're like, the hell it will.
Yeah, Yeah, exactly. Well, what's interesting about that is even though we avoid the physicality, we embrace suffering. Because we believe as a culture that suffering equals reward. And the greater suffering equals greater reward. So the industry skips the journey part and just says, here's a bunch of suffering that's going to give you this awesome reward.
And so the gyms that make you suffer, right, that punish you, that drive you into the ground, are more successful because in the short term, they can deliver, you know,
they can deliver the
20 pound weight loss.
Right, exactly.
Right. If you can hang in there for the first 90 days as we beat the crap out of you, right, your body's going to change.
Sure, but not your relationship with it, unless it's for the worse. It'll actually give you a more distorted version of that relationship with your body. If you were to take you and your body to counseling, the counselor would say, this is an abusive relationship. And if our goal is to create a better relationship with our body, that's probably not the path we want to go.
No, not at all.
So the welcome program, unfortunately, now is selling the suffering. Chip and Dave ripped the fitness industry's ass.
Something that I think that is so vital to everybody, period. You have a body, regardless of your circumstances, you benefit from this.
Yeah,
period.
You have a relationship with that body.
But the vast majority of us see this as an absolute drudgery. Something to, you know, something to be checked off, like, okay, I went to the gym today, you know, or I went to the gym this week, or I saw my personal trainer and I did that thing that I know I'm supposed to do, but for which there's absolutely no joy for.
Yeah, yeah. And it doesn't necessarily lead to a greater relationship with your body.
No, not at all. In fact, it can't.
It can create more distance with your body than anything.
Yeah.
We'll get through this anyway. Get through it any way possible. That's how we survive trauma. Mm-hmm. And that's what workouts become. Just get through this any way possible.
Which ultimately means that it cannot be beneficial.
Yeah, it's actually going to disconnect you, if anything.
Yeah, I mean, just by the very nature of the fact that you started from a place of, I'm going to deal like this as if it were trauma.
Yes.
Ergo, it is trauma. Ergo, you're not going to get any better from this.
Never buy words for quality.
Yeah.
Especially in movement or relationship with your body.
Like, how do we introduce the 85%? To this movement and strength practice?
Well, I think it fundamentally starts with where you are right now. You start with a conversation. Where are the bumps and hiccups in your life? Where are the places where you feel you need to improve? Okay, all right, now we see what gets in the way, we see where you want to go, and then we can start charting a more accurate path. Something that actually begins with what you're physically capable of right now.
Wait, are you saying we should plan? And assess? It seems so obvious, and yet you walk into most gyms and their welcome program is, come into this class. Yeah. No, that's not how it should work. That's like saying, I don't know what your math ability is, but come to my Algebra 3 class, or come to my trigonometry class.
You'll catch up.
You'll suffer the entire time, but you'll get something out of it. So if you have a gym that just lets people into your classes, then there is no planning, there is no assessment, there is no concept of the individual as a goal-striving, hopefully empowered person. It's simply, we're going to make you sweat, we're going to get you tired, and we all know that because the more tired you get, the better you are as a human.
Oh my God, I was so sore after my last workout. It was such a good workout.
Which is the fabulous fitness fallacy. We know that building skills will make you tired. So we believe the inverse, that just because you're getting tired, somehow you're building skills. And that just simply isn't true